Scott and I met when we were almost 1 year old. He was wearing white diapers, rubber pants, and no shirt. He was dressed exactly like me. When I looked into his clear gray eyes, my heart started up again. Our family had just moved from the city to the suburbs, 1953. His family had the house next door. In fact, our house wasn't even finished yet. My dad decided he himself would build the low brick wall out in front of the house around the future plants. I've never seen him so happy. Scott's mom and my mom became friends. We got to see a lot of each other. Mostly they came over to my house because we kept on having kids. Now, until recently, Scott and I had still been having a little bit of trouble sitting up by ourselves, so we'd gotten into the habit of trying to get him to set the first one of us down next to something so we could lean on that. Then get the other one down next to us and they could lean on us and we could just sit there together leaning. Looking at chair legs, sofa legs, coffee table legs. That one has a chip in it. I didn't do it. The chair I leaned against most often had this dark green upholstery with this raised broken line pattern like dotted Swiss, except lines, not Swiss, or dots. Must have had a little bit of wool in it too, because after a while leaning on it, my cheek would get all red and itchy. And I get this imprinted pattern, the kind of broken raised lines on my cheek. But I didn't mind, because I was with Scott. I could feel his arm on me. It was a little sweaty with summer. Sometimes they put us in the playpen together, which was better than being there by yourself. Scott would practice walking. I'd sit back against one set of bars, and he'd go over to the other. He'd grab one bar in one hand, he'd grab the other bar in the other hand, and he'd pull himself up, fist over fist, his knuckles white, using all his strength. Then he'd get to the top, and he'd stay there for a second, then he'd let go. Then he'd go this way, a little bit. Then he'd go back a little bit. Boom! He'd fall and be down. I never took my eyes off him. I watched him like a hawk. I figured I'd wait to try until I knew I could do it. Wednesday night was Dale Carnegie. How to win friends and influence people? That man sure made a lot of records. On Wednesday nights, my dad would assign us to listen to a record side. While he was out of town selling repair jobs on big generators for Westinghouse, he was a marketing executive. I guess Dale was kind of like his stand-in. Then on Friday nights, he'd get us all a dinner and quiz the hell out of us. A lot wrote on our answers: allowances, tour duty, permission to go out. Capitalism was the spiritual and structural model for our family. Dad was to own the boss, Mom was the manager, and us kids were kind of a combination wage worker and entrepreneur. We got a certain set amount of money every week for doing our chores, and after that, it was up to us. We rented blouses to each other for 50 cents. Belts were a quarter, I think. You could trade, like, get your brother a glass of water when you got home from school from the kitchen, and for that you get a handful of the popcorn that he'd already made and was eating while he was watching TV. Like capitalism, divide and conquer was the central strategy from the top on down. Stealing was completely acceptable as long as you got away with it. As far as we could tell, it was a dog-eat-dog world, and the thought of forming a union never entered our minds. About 7 o'clock, Wednesday night, 6 kids sitting around this little silver and blue portable record player, listening as if our lives depended on it. Now, if my dad couldn't get his hands on Dale, we got one of the two men with 3 names, Richard Clement Stone or Norman Vincent Peale. Nobody told us these guys weren't gods. They all seemed to agree on one thing. It didn't really matter if you were happy. Didn't really matter if you felt good about yourself. What mattered was how others saw you. Confident or hesitant. Dynamic or indecisive. Backslapper or backstabber. What mattered was how you shook the man's hand. Stand up straight, for God's sakes. Chin up, chest out, and call a man by his first name as often as possible. He'll really like that. Oh, and look a man in the eye. Nobody ever thinks somebody who looks him in the eye could ever be trying to sell something they didn't want, wouldn't work, couldn't pay for. Somebody's got to be the best. Why not you? This fella's going to buy from somebody. Why not you? The power of positive thinking. If only one man could put bread on his table, why not you? You got to get up every morning and look in that mirror and ask yourself, am I willing to do what it takes today to be the best? I looked at my dad. I looked at my mom. I looked at my neighbors. I looked at the pictures of Dale and Richard and Norman on the album covers, and I decided to become nobody special. A waitress, a taxi cab driver, a supermarket checkout clerk. I decided to become a carpenter.
Thank you.
auction days begin at 6 or 7, end at 10 or 11. There's mule tire, which comes from carrying sheetrock up 7 flights of stairs for 5 days in a row. They're so weary from installing ceiling tile over your head for 20, 30, 40 years. There's a heart sick from never being able to do as good a job as you can because of time and or money. And then there's this sort of brain dead, which comes from keeping thousands of thoughts in your head for several months if you're running a big job. Details, like the special combination switch plug electrical plate that needs to go with the combination fan heater so that the combination washer dryer can sit right flush against the wall in the combination laundry room bathroom. Or the fact that you have to soon cut into a gas line that may be live, but 3 attempts have proved it untraceable. The only other alternative being shutting off the gas in the entire 48 apartment unit building, which would cause all the stove pilots to go out, in which case they'd have to be relit, for which access would need to be gained to every apartment or permission obtained. Who's going to pay for this anyway, since time ago when the client doesn't have a lot of money? Of course, cutting into a live gas line could precipitate a fiery explosion and kill whoever cut it. As well as all the other workers on the job who you've hired. Blowing the building to smithereens, making the headlines for sure. Then there's the asbestos in the ceiling. Never mind asbestos in the ceiling.
Thank you.
On this big job, I spent 3 days at the top of the ladder shooting track into a concrete ceiling with a gun that uses gunpowder and shoots nails. Now, to warn the other workers to brace themselves for the sound before I pull the trigger the whole time, I'd yell, "Shooting!" at the top of my lungs. A couple years later, I ran up with the same painters from the first job on a different job. Their most vivid memory of that earlier job was me precariously balanced at the top of the 10-foot ladder, yelling, "Judy!" before I pulled the trigger for 3 whole days. They figured out among themselves, I must be really mad at Judy. One job, we built these hardwood maple wall caps with beveled glass doors, 14 inches deep, just like the architect's bed. After estimating, cutting, gluing, assembly, sanding, finishing, delivering, and installing them, they looked great. The clients, who had both ended their first marriages, recently gotten married to each other and now had 12 children between them, discovered that their 16-inch Belgian china plates wouldn't fit in these wall caps, and that's why they had glass doors in the first place. Thank you. Maybe plaster debris from washing our tools clogged up the drain. On the other hand, maybe the client forgot to put the washing machine hose into the drain pipe. But a lot of water went down one, then the next floor down. Plaster ceiling down in spots, rugs all wet, floor finish ruined. And the water just missing this woman's dead, famous to her husband's oil paintings. Worth $1 million, every single one. Lucky me. Maybe if I hadn't been raised Protestant. I like the sound of construction, more when I make it. The scream of a circular saw as it bites into a two-by. The zzz, zzz, of a screw gun. Zzz, zzz. The outrageous grating of BX as it's pulled through a metal stud. And the yelp of an old nail as you pull it out of the wood it's been holding on to for more than 100 years. The sound of welders' torches like orange waterfalls. The colors of construction, color in a bucket, kick-ass green, riding a 4-inch-wide brush down an old yellow back door, laughed head off. The smell of concrete, musty, old, with a tang of lime. The fact that concrete keeps getting harder and harder, 1 year, 10 years, 100 years, 1,000 years, harder and harder, whether you want it to or not. The people in construction, Tony number one. Fuck you, fuck you, fuck you, fuck you, fuck you! The steel China doll, a great plumber. Rebecca, you're the boss. John Quiet, Peter Noisy. Vinny in Cleveland. Marty, Marty, Marty. Tony number two. Fuck you, fuck you, fuck you, fuck you, fuck you! The noise of building. Cast iron pipes, bell ring crack when a chain wrench snaps one piece, and then the sound of the cut piece as it hits the floor. At 37 years old, my life has gotten easier. I can see more of the choices. I can see that there are choices. I got this friend who keeps a mental list of everything he wants to do in his life, and out of this list, he decides how to spend his day to day. I think he's up to number 674. And besides having an extraordinary memory, he's quite relaxed about it. He figures, why the hell not put it down? My list, learn Spanish, number 27. Keep up with current events, number 8. Get closer with my 3 sisters, number 18. Make a lot of money, a lot of money, a lot of money. Get health insurance. And buy a house right on the ocean. Realistically, number 57, 95, 57. Make it possible for every human being born to have a decent life, number 3. Might as well have it down. I might live to be 700. The list stays more or less the same. Every now and then there's a radical restructuring, and the way I spend my daily days changes a bit. A close friend's parent dies and we spend a lot of time together. I get a chance to do a show somewhere. A friend gets diagnosed with AIDS. Or like the decision 2 years ago to break up with my lover after 17 years. The woman I was going to live the rest of my 700 years with. Round don't fit square. There are 3 types of lock knob sets. You got your mortise, your tubular, and your cylindrical. Lock knob sets are classified by method of installation. Mortise is the most difficult. She left me long before I saw what was happening. I figured if she just helped one with the dishes, vacuuming, tidying up, that would bring her back, tie her into the past, the future, the present. Now your round holes are for your knobs and your latches. Your square is for the latch, face, and the strike plate. Precision is essential when you're installing a lock. Every piece has a purpose and each piece has a place. I guess you didn't really leave me at all, but just dug so deep down far inside herself, I couldn't find her. Now, after replacing an old mortise type lock, plain or decorative percussion plates can be used to cover or conceal or hide any ugly damage, marks, or holes. I insist. I look back. 17 years. I insist I remember. Installing a lock is a simple operation if you follow the directions supplied by the manufacturer. One set screw missing, door dropped down and scraping, old hole 3/4 inches off of where new hole needs to be, bit dull. Bitterness and blame. Desperate battles over everything that didn't matter. Disappointment, so old. Even our iron looks tired. And at night, each of us coming home, the touch of the front doorknob, turning our pleasure to pain and then to rage. Who were we so looking forward to seeing? Who were we mad at? Mortise elsewhere, be careful to not spill out its contents. Many parts are small and easily lost. Spring placement is crucial. Hogged up my heart for years, spreading things out, took up space. I liked it. Now I search for a different place to put her, to the left. The right, no, over. Is where the key fits in. It is a critical part of any lock installation. Every mortise lock has a cylinder. If you simply load the cylinder hard enough, it will go in easily. Problems still arise, love harder. Use any tool you have available for the job. Homeowners seldom have all the tools necessary for any particular job. Lover. Ex-lover, lover, ex-lover, lover, ex. Lover, for 17 years that other room didn't exist. To conceive the inconceivable. To imagine what doesn't exist is an important part of any home project. As the work progresses, occasionally step back and notice your surroundings, as well as the possible successful completion of the project. A lock and the knob set working, their action smooth, the spindle straight, the knob round, the button firm, the latch catching the strike plane perfectly. Every time. Ex. Lover. A term of endearment.
Thank you.
Killer Brick Memorial Wall. Jack. Used to be the foreman long before I got there. Now he's on the line. Didn't want distress. Florida sun low in the sky. Early spring's chilly breezes. 1972. For 2 months, the block I lay slipped and tilt, buttered in, steam unbuttered, holes in my joints and those joints unstruck. For 2 months, bloody, lime-eaten fingertips, alone on the line, the 6:30 sun and eight men had no comment. For 2 months, the sun came up long after I did hot coffee and lemon meringue pie at 5 a.m. More on here! For 2 months. And then Jack, 45 and balding, comes from behind, grabbing my wrist, squeezing so tight my heart jumps hard. Jack. Dead in 9 more months of white lung from cutting block. Jack, he knows this. Jack, wrapping his own hand completely around my own big hand, Jack. This is how you hold a trowel. He knew exactly what he was doing, Tony, running into back into the fire like that. It had been his job, a side job, and glad to get it. Him and 2 other guys refinishing an old oak paneling in a den in a brownstone in Greenwich Village. Made the papers. They were working hard, pushing late, Christmas Eve, trying to finish the job so that the family could have their Christmas Eve party in that very den later on at midnight. All of a sudden, the house in flames, a fireball. Tony and the 2 guys made it out of the window, the babysitter and 2 kids trapped inside, or so Tony thought. He knew he had to go back in. It had been his job. Tony, Kathy's favorite guy to work with. Never knew her name, woman who fell from the roof. Carpenter, contractor. Partners with another woman who didn't fall from the roof. Dead, neck broke, end of day, balance lost. Had she just carried up the final roll of paper? Last bundle of shingles, her power cord wrapped just right. When you start to fall up there, the pitch pushing you over, always over, you grab your hammer and you wildly try to smash the claws into the plywood, into the joists, into the rafters, into the gutter, into the air, into the shakes, into the signal. You're wildly swinging your arm, your feet slipping, your head spinning. Don't let go of your hammer, woman who fell from the rope! Don't let go of your hammer! Had she turned to admire the sun's final pink gleam on the plywood seams? So straight, so square, so snug, so... The very first story told to me on my very first day and my very first three jobs. You know, honey, sweetie, a man died right where you're standing just the other day. Blocks were just three or four high, just like they are now. Well, he might have made it, but he only two stories down, but he fell on them steel poles sticking up. Tie rods, rebar, waiting for the next pour. One went through his stomach, the other went through his chest and came out as a neck. We got down there, he was looking around. We told him he's going to be all right. Butch went to his car and got a bottle. We gave it to him, held it up so he could drink it. Finally, he kind of passed out. Then the ambulance men came. They didn't know what to do. Finally, we all just like lifted him up as high as we could like a baby. He died right quick after that. The very first story told to me on the very first day, my very first three different jobs. Quite a guy. Johnson, old Johnson. Then he was 72, now he'd have been 89. Old blue plaid shirt, old black leather belt, old blue jeans, Johnson. A part of the job, shoveling mud, delivering blocks, 40 tons a day, hoist and stack, the blocks hollow thunk as they hit together, mason tender, for 50 years. Big fella, no smiles, no chatter, grandfather to someone. Only man on the job with a last name. Only dark man I ever saw doing construction in Florida. First day on the job, I asked him his first name. Three or four condominiums later, he passed by me and said, "Mister." Her son was the builder. She'd raised him on his own the nights had been short, the days long, she'd done the best she could, and now he'd built enough houses for other people, he could build one for his own. Eager like a builder, proud like the 30-year-old white man that he was. Slate stone entry, master bathroom off the master bedroom. Room for his mother down on the first floor, double sink vanity in the children's bathroom. Working on weekends. One Saturday, his mother and three kids come to visit. Up on the second floor, she stepped through the hole left for the chimney as if it wasn't there. Died as she hit the ground. They kept the house. Moved in by fall. Their children growing through high school there. Her son was the builder. The builder was her son. Easy come, easy go. I think his wife had left him the day before. Eh, you win some, you lose some. Smart woman by the sound of it. Not a bad guy, just nobody you'd pick to have lunch with. Skinny, jumpy with a fast, bony laugh. Mr. No Skin Off My Teeth swung a hammer mean and clean if he thought somebody was watching. Don't let the screen door hit you! His daily goodbye. Late one day, after a quick poker coffee break, he grabbed up the sheet of plywood, wind came up and blew him and that plywood right off the 20th floor. Dragged him 30, 40 feet before he went over the edge. Wouldn't let go. Dug his heels in on that one. Him and that plywood sailing off down towards McDonald's. Hold on. Mr. Easy Come, Easy Go. Hold on. Then boom, I'm dead. Me dead. 84 years old. Damn! I figured I'd at least make 100 just being the 21st century and all. I had about 1 second when I knew this is it. At least 20 times before in my life I thought, this must be it. This time I knew. My mother, who'd been dead 20 years, was pulling on my hair as hard as she could, and my lover, who hadn't been dead yet, was pulling on my feet. I'd waited all my life for this, and all I could do was watch. Way deep inside me, this little voice says, no, no, not now. No, not now. And then this other voice goes, oh. March 4th. What a stupid day to die. And life, did I get it? I mean, was there anything to be gotten? Did I pick the right things to emphasize? Was I supposed to pick? I mean, am I glad I got the chance to be alive? 1 second. Hey, there's that scarf. I'm taking out the tub over at 14th Street. That cut was so bad, I couldn't even look at it. The guy at the corner coffee shop, the cashier from Bangladesh, he cleaned it. He put bandages on it like a surgeon, then he sprayed Bactine all over it and all these little toothpicks sitting in a cup by the cashier. Then this humming in my ears starts getting louder, this humming low like bees or like angels. Oh no, not angels! I started to miss my mom like when I was one. I could smell the carpet in my grandmother's apartment hallway. My lover's face was right over me, but it was getting further away, or maybe I was. Was this it? I mean, what was going to happen to me? Where was I going to go? Would I come back?